New Orleans quarterback Kyle Sloter, thank you so much for joining us today.
Absolutely. Thank you for having me.
You know, Kyle, currently you're the USFL passing leader. But I tell you what, there's got to be at least three passes, one particular with 6 seconds left this past weekend you'd like to have back. Talk to me about the game and the team's morale with two games left to play in the regular season.
Yeah, you know, I think we, from a morale standpoint, I think that, you know, we're sitting in a good place, a good headspace as a team. You know, if you play the game long enough, you're going to lose some close games. It was a tough one, you know, with 6 seconds left, kind of felt like I had to make something happen. You don't have a lot of time, obviously, so you got to push the ball down the field in tight windows and, you know, tried to make one guy miss in the pocket. And then, you know, it took a hit while throwing the last one, and it just happened to not go our way. It could have very easily fallen into the hands of our guys, but it didn't. And it was a tough game for sure. I mean, there was a lot of points that felt like, you know, there could be some, you know, you make a play here or there, you win that game. So it was unfortunate the way that it goes, but like I said, you're going to lose games if you play football, and it's really just rebounding. And I think that as a team, we have a good, mindset going forward.
You know, we talked about the three picks, 10 on the year, but it's hard not to be the league leader in interceptions when you're throwing the ball more than anyone. Let's look at some of these impressive numbers, Kyle. We've got your first in completions, 161. First in attempts, 277. First in attempts per game, 34.6. We've got, here's the stat that I think we all love, first in passing yards, 1750, a whopping 248 over the number two quarterback in the league. I mean, these numbers are impressive. You're fourth in the league on touchdowns with 9, just 2 behind the leader. And, of course, a 10th rushing touchdown, showing you had some wheels the other day with a big game winner on that as well. What do these numbers, what do they represent to you?
Yeah, you know, going into this, I kind of just wanted to play the game the way that I feel like I can play the game. And I feel like, you know, the numbers will take care of themselves if your eyes are in the right place, you're making the right throws and doing the right things. As far as the interceptions go, I think that's probably the thing that bugs me the most, because I've never been an interception guy. You know, too many times, and we talked about it today, too many times we talked about being better at, and this is going to sound silly, but I need to be better at taking sacks as opposed to seeing a guy breathing down my neck and seeing, like, you know, you look at one of the interceptions, the second one that I had in the last game, I see Johnny Dixon coming wide open down the field for a touchdown, but I've got a guy, you know, right in my face. So it's like, do you try to make that throw? You know, step up in the pocket and take the hit and make the throw, or do you just, you know, cut your losses? And, you know, too many times, if you look at the interceptions, too many times, I think we said 6 of them today, 6 of the 10, I'm being hit while throwing. And, you know, it's not a knock on the offensive line. It's just, you know, I have to, they're not going to win every time, just like I'm not going to make a great throw every time. So when, you know, it does happen that they don't necessarily win their block, I can't compound it and make it worse by trying to be a, you know, what we said today, a superhero, and trying to make a throw that you should just, you know, cut your losses, take the sack, be safe. So at times I get it in my head that, you know, I want to go out here and make the play no matter what, whereas sometimes it's not smart. So I got to be better about just taking sacks, cutting the losses, playing a little bit smarter in that area. But, you know, as far as, you know, our team goes and the numbers go, I think that it speaks volumes to, you know, the receivers and what they're able to do. You know, they make my job easy. I think that we've got a very talented group out there. Offensive line has done a great job for the most part of this year. You know, it's been a blessing to play with these guys. And, you know, the numbers, you try not to think about them too much, because you don't want to be a guy that is statistically driven. So I'm just out there. The one stat that I care about each week, I would give up all the stats in the world to win a game. So if I got to hand the ball off 50 times a game or throw the ball 60 times a game, I'd rather get that win in the win column more so than the other things that come along with it.
You know, when I you go back and you look at the original USFL, the first people that come to mind are usually Herschel Walker, Reggie White. Yep. But you also think about the Jim Kellys, the Steve Youngs, the Doug Williams, and of course, the USFL's all-time leading passer and former New Orleans Saint, Bobby Hebert. What are those, you know, those guys being able to start their illustrious careers in the USFL, what does that mean to you?
Yeah, I think it just means that if you can play the game, that you can play at the highest level. So if you can play, if you can play the game at the college level as a, you know, FCS or D2 player, they're going to come find you. Just like, you know, I was an FCS quarterback myself and have 5 years in the NFL. I think that if you prove that you can throw the ball, and if you can make the right reads and do the things that, you know, it goes beyond playing quarterback. If you're just a guy that can play the game, they're going to come find you. So, you know, those guys are great examples of people that, you know, played well at this level and got an opportunity and went on to succeed in the NFL with the chances that they got later on down the road. So, you know, it's definitely something I think about. That was the reason I wanted to come here, was because, you know, more than anything, I just wanted to show, you know, how really the things that I've been talking about for the last 5 years of, like, I really truly believe that, like, I can play in the NFL, that, you know, I can be a not only just play, but be a great player. So I really just wanted to show the physical attributes and the mental toughness and the physical toughness and all the things that I think the USFL has given us a platform to display for these teams. So super, you know, thankful and blessed to have the opportunity. You know, it doesn't always, like, you look at the USFL and how much time we had before the season. And this is something that I tell people all the time. People like to forget that we had 3 weeks before the season got going. So whereas, you know, the NFL has 20 something week off season and they got 4 preseason games and everybody's, you know, we can't put in an extensive playbook. Like, we have a very, very limited playbook, and it's not because of the talent or the guys, you know, brain power. It's more so just, you don't have time in the week to, you got to be good at your bread and butter and you got to move on. You don't have time to, you know, put in a John Gruden 300 play playbook, you know, going into each week. So, you know, I tell people all the time that the product is not going to always look like the NFL, because it's not an NFL product. It is a product that, you know, for this first year, we were trying to get guys on the field and get time and get, you know, guys out there so they can show what they can do before the NFL season starts. So it's not always going to be, you know, football as you know it, but it's a great platform to be able to go out there, especially this first year on short notice, and show people what you can do just from an athletic standpoint. And if you have the ability to play the next level.
You know, Kyle, you mentioned those 5 seasons in the NFL. Talk to me a little bit about the differences of the 2 leagues, perhaps from a cultural standpoint, from your perspective.
Yeah. So, you know, just from a cultural standpoint, you know, I would say that the NFL is obviously it's a huge billion-dollar business. You know, they have been doing it for a very long time. The USFL is trying to build a brand of, you know, guys that really just need a shot. Really, you know, we keep talking about that, the cultural, it's hard-nosed guys that just never really received an opportunity, or were told that they weren't good enough, and guys that, you know, still have the ability to play and feel like they can go play at the next level. This is kind of giving us a springboard to, you know, hopefully do that. So, you know, like I said, the differences between the 2 leagues, the NFL, where we sit right now in today's, you know, landscape, the NFL in terms of talent and your top end starters and all that kind of stuff is far superior in terms of talent. I think that the challenge is that this is just as a quarterback, I think, in doing your job, having been in the NFL for 5 years and walking in every single day and having a statistician hand me a sheet of paper that says, hey, on 3rd and 5, they blitz 50% of the time, and having another person walk in and say, hey, this guy is hurt this week, this is what we're watching. You have, like, Kirk Cousins, when I was with him, he had, you know, the entire organization of like 50, 60, 70 people all pulling in the same direction to pull together this game plan that is, you know, mulled over for, you know, hours and hours and hours throughout the week. Whereas, you know, and they got people drawing up the pictures, they got the attention to detail. Like, we don't have GAs, we don't have, like, our coaches are doing everything. They don't have time to, you know, do all the the little sheets of paper and all the different things. So like, I've told this to, you know, people close to me as well, is that, you know, as far as just, you know, what we're able to do, if you take talent aside in terms of the amount of time that we have together, the playbook, because there's a lot of things we want to put in for different answers. Like, we don't have answers for a lot of things that, you know, that you would have in the NFL should you be given a situation. So basically what I'm trying to say is, talent aside, this is the hardest brand of football that I've played before. Just given all the different, you know, barriers. And it, I think that if you can play at this level, I think that if you can show that you can play at this level with all the different, you know, we're, our facility is the Sheraton at the, you know, in Birmingham. You know, it's not the Minnesota Vikings, Twin Cities Orthopedia, you know, what they got going on. It's different. You don't have the same recovery options. You don't have the same, and it's not to say that the USFL isn't trying to give us that. It's just that they're in the first year of operations. So, you know, I think that it's easy to look at and try to do apples to apples, but you just can't. From like I think Kirk Cousins is a guy that I spent a lot of time with. I think if you bring a Kirk Cousins and put him in the USFL, I think that he's going to have a lot of the same struggles that, you know, guys in the NFL or the USFL, the quarterbacks here are having. You know, it's a different type of football, just given the time constraints and the resources allotted to us. So it's, I think that the differences really lie there.
You know, you had a very unique collegiate career in that you played not only quarterback, but you also played wide receiver there at Southern Miss before transferring and finishing your collegiate career under center at Northern Colorado. Talk to me about how perhaps playing both positions have helped you at quarterback position.
Yeah, you know, I have a unique perspective and I'm very thankful for it. You know, one of the things that, you know, I think playing the receiver position helped me, you know, as I transitioned back to quarterback, was really understanding like where I would want the ball. So like, I tried to throw the ball, and what I mean by that is, you know, if I've got a crossing route, if I've got a particular play, so we've got a crossing route, a deep cross from right to left, and they're playing cover two, where they've got a safety high, you know, sometimes you can, there's a, depending on what the backers do and how they move and rotate, you might have a hole, you know, before he gets to that safety. Well, if you lead him with the football, he's going to just, you're going to throw him into a huge blow up hit, a knockout hit, whereas, which I've felt those before. So, you know, as a receiver and having played that position, I was always like, well, if the quarterback could just slow me down, like throw it back shoulder. So I slowed my momentum down so I could catch in this hole and it'd be like a back turned, like glancing blow. Those are the kinds of things, like, you know, if I was running a go ball and I had a guy stacked, like I beat him down the field, I want it over the top. Whereas if he's high hipped, you know, I want it back shoulder. So it's those types of things that you kind of understand what the receiver is looking for. And you also want to make them comfortable, especially running over the middle. So I think that that's something that gave me a unique perspective of really what's open and what's not open.
You're one win away from clinching a playoff berth. You've got Tampa Bay this weekend. What needs to be done to clinch on Sunday and not, you know, take it to a game 10 there in week 10?
Yep. Yeah. So I think, you know, really going into this week with the mindset that we need to be focused, we need to prepare, because I mentioned that you do have some of those barriers. So you have to be a pro of handling your own business, watching your own film. You have to go the extra mile. So I think as a team, you know, we need to just focus in on the task at hand. I think that this next game is going to be crucial in terms of execution. I think from an offensive standpoint, that was probably our best game in terms of just, you know, walking down the field. From both a player and coaching perspective, I felt like the play calls that game were, you know, probably the best that we had had all year in terms of the rhythm that we were able to create of moving the ball, you know, gradually down the field, taking time off, and then ultimately ending in touchdowns as opposed to field goals. I also think that, you know, more than anything, taking care of the football, whether it's interceptions or fumbles, I think that we just need to be conscious, and it's the ball's in my hands most of the time. So I need to be conscious of, you know, I was once told that if we can end every possession, and this is something that goes back to high school for me, but if we can end every possession in a kick, whether it's a punt, a field goal, an extra point, you know, then we're probably going to win the game. So the goal for me is probably, like I said, to not try to do too much, in terms of, you know, if I have somebody breathing down my neck, you know, just probably go down, take a sack, maybe try to create with my legs or something like that, as opposed to, you know, standing in there and, you know, maybe taking a hit while I'm throwing and have the ball flail out like it has six times this year for me. So I'm just going to, you know, take what's given to me and try to just take care of the football as best I can, because I know that that's really where the game changes.
The Breakers, I believe, are 1-3, 1-4 lifetime on Saturday. This game, this week against the Bandits on a Sunday. Are you guys aware of this stat? Is there a bit of a Saturday curse going on? Talk to me about playing on that sixth day of the week.
Yeah, you know, I don't know that I was aware of it, but now that you say it, I feel like we are a Sunday team. You know, when you play a Sunday game and then you turn around and you play on Saturday, it's definitely a challenge. It's easier. It's for sure easier to go from Saturday to Saturday. It's really not so much the day as much as it is the time and the time to recover, because, you know, we're creatures of habit. You know, humans are just creatures of habit. And when you play the game of football, you definitely are. So, you know, after your Sunday game, you come in Monday, you watch the film, you may do a little workout, a little bit like a run or something like that. Then you have the rest of the day off. Then Tuesday, you're off. So, you know, last week or whenever you play Sunday and Saturday, we just have Monday where we come in, watch the film, and then you get a half day. And then Tuesday is right back to work because you've lost the day. So you've got to do Tuesday, which is your base downs. It's first and second down day where you're just putting in your base game plan. Next day is third down on Wednesday. Thursday is your red zone. And then Friday, you're kind of, so when you lose that day, it just kind of throws you off a little bit. Like walking into the building to play on the sixth day, as opposed to now we've had, like, we went from Saturday to a Sunday. Now we've had 8 days and we had that extra day off. It does something for your body. It does something for your mindset when it's like, okay, I've got the extra day to put in the time in the film room. I've got a little bit more time to spread out really over the course of the week, as opposed to when you lose a day, it's cram, 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 cram. And then you're playing before you know it. So it's crazy. The turnaround, the one day makes a big, big difference just in terms of your preparation and your process. So like, you know, you got so many people that are superstitious and all that kind of stuff. I don't necessarily believe in all that, but it's more so your process gets altered and changed and you have to adjust. And when you've been doing things right and you feel like, hey, this works for me and now I got to change it, it's tough.
How eager, how much does the team, yourself personally, want the Breakers to come home to New Orleans?
You know, for me, so growing up, I kind of became a man, went from, you know, going to high school, you know, 18 years old to Southern Miss and spending 3 years there. And, you know, I grew up a Falcons fan, but you spend so much time. I was down in New Orleans a bunch, just being, you know, an hour and a half, 2 hours north of New Orleans in Hattiesburg, kind of became a little bit of a Saints fan. Just it's just like when you go to the city, it's just kind of an intoxicating feeling of like, you feel the sports, you feel it just like radiate out of the city. Everybody's a rabid New Orleans Saints fan. And, you know, I think that it's, to me, I wouldn't, if I had to choose a team to play for in the USFL, it would be New Orleans, just because I feel like, you know, being there in the city, I think that we would get a lot more. I know it's not the Saints, but I think that we would get a lot more support. And I think it would actually shock a lot of people. You know, I talk to Saints fans, or not Saints fans, but New Orleans fans all the time. Just New Orleans sports fans. I feel like they support, they're good at supporting whoever's there. So I would love to be in New Orleans. I've said it a million times that, you know, I think we would be the Stallions of, you know, 2022 if we were in New Orleans, because there's an undeniable home field advantage. They've got people here. You know, I think that when you're quote unquote at home, even if they're the away team, you know, the refs are probably more likely to call things in your favor, which that felt like it was that way on Saturday. You know, I think that if we're in New Orleans, I think that we probably have 2-3 more wins. I think we're probably the undefeated team. So it's, we've got the ability, we've got the talent. I still believe with all my heart that we're the best team in this league. It's just a matter of focusing, putting it all together. I think from a personnel standpoint that, you know, I think we're going to win it all. So that's just my, that's my mindset. And we haven't played anybody that I feel like is better than us. I feel like we beat ourselves when we played the Generals, and I feel like we beat ourselves twice with Stallions. So I feel like we have yet to be beaten by a team. So we're excited. We're excited to get another crack at them if it comes to that. So we've got a lot of confidence, and we're going to take it into the playoffs with us should we get this win this week.
New Orleans. Hey, you beat Tampa Bay on Sunday, the Breakers are in the playoffs. Playoffs begin on June 25th. They'll be held in Canton at the Pro Football Hall of Fame. Tickets for the USFL playoffs and championship games are available at Hall of Fame Village. That's HOFVillage.com. So by all means, for those that want to travel and support the Breakers, support Kyle, by all means, do so. And of course, the games are always televised. But, Kyle, thank you so much for joining me, brother.
Yeah, thank you for having me. I really appreciate it.
All right, great time. Good luck this weekend, and we look forward to talking to you again come playoff time.